Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 495. We're five away from the big 500 episode. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitters in the Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA. Really ready to talk some professional wrestling. And we got a bunch of guys on the line. Our crew, as it stands, first of all, Papa Lunchbox from the lunch meeting from hell. There he is, all dressed up for the show.
Yeah, that's true. Hi, everybody. How's it going? I'm wearing a bow tie, so I can officially be listed as an expert on Wikipedia.
And also with us from Johnstown, PA, Flood City, USA, it is Bobby FJ Town.
Hi, everybody. I am still a little sleep deprived from this weekend, but I'm here for your pleasure.
And that's, after raising with the crew over $600 in Extra Life 24-hour gaming marathon. Congratulations on that, Bobby FJ Town. And also
and Lunchbox
is a part of it as well. And also with us from California, PA, he is the birthday boy. He is Wheels, and he has a selfie strick.
Selfie stick?
Sure.
That's a generic selfie stick.
Yes, yeah, it's a selfie stick you get from Five Below.
Just like you, Fleck. It's generic, just like you.
Oh. And you heard him there. The insults are already being wielded across the internet here in studio. Back with us. They're the proprietors of Code Red Wrestling. Fleck and Sera Feeny, friends of the show. Longtime friends of the show. How's it going? Welcome back to the studio. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having us, Sorg. What's up, Team FNF out there? Feeny Army. Lunchbox, Bobby, it's been a while. Wheels, it's been a while.
What's up?
Yeah, of course.
I want to talk about it a little further in the show, but real quick, you guys do have a show coming up for a good cause. I want you to get your plug real quick out of the way at the beginning here.
That's right. Thank you. Fleck, want to take this one?
No, Feeny, you can take this one.
Thank you. November 21st, Century 3 Mall. Doors open 4:30. Show starts at 5. We are supporting the Paul 2015. It is called Paul Slam, and all proceeds go to White Oak Animal Safe Haven. It is one of the only no-kill shelters in the area. Fleck and I had the opportunity to go and check them out, spend some time with the animals. There's plenty of animals looking for good homes, so highly recommend checking them out. Give them a like on Facebook, and hope to see you at Paul Slam.
Awesome. Check out coderedwrestling.webs.com. For the information there as well. And we'll talk about that a little more here in the show. Of course, this is Wrestling Mayhem Show. Check us out at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can subscribe to us on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and all kinds of other places, video and audio formats. Please follow us at Mayhem Show on Twitter, on Facebook, on Google+, and we got a great Facebook group going on as well for the Wrestling Mayhem Show. And please also drop us a line to that email address you guys know and love.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can also drop us a line to the phone number 412-207. That's almost the wrong number. WMS0. 412-206-WMS0. You can also join
us.
What? Did I say something different?
You said 207.
207. 407 is my other company name. 407-SORG. But anyways, big thanks to our Patreons that are supporting the show. You can also join us here live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com every Tuesday night about 9 p.m. Eastern time. It may not be about wrestling for the first half hour, but it's going to be fun. But also thanks to our Patreon supporters at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. Okay.
Nice.
The WrestlingRevolution.com, our oldest of contributors here on the show. Ed Burke joining us, and of course our good friend Bo Diggity,
woo,
who pays us $1 an episode, so I say his name like that. So you can become part of it. Hey, if you're at the $5 level, we have if you do the $5 level, you are an executive producer. You're putting a big stake into the show. And over on the Awesome Cast, we've had two people doing that here for over 4 weeks. So they're getting business cards very soon. We just got the designs in. They look really cool. So if you guys want to become a part of that, we will support you as anytime you make a claim as an executive producer of the show, for as long as you hold up that side of the of contributions. So
can
please
we do tote bags at $20 like PBS.
Mm-hmm. We might have to go a little higher for tote bags. Well, yeah, $20 okay. per episode. Yeah, I'll give you a damn tote bag. You'll get a tote bag.
$500 per episode for tote bags.
No. $20. I think I'd give you a tote bag. For sure. But, I mean, you'd have to keep
just
it up.
Just go to Giant Eagle and grab one. We didn't say what kind of tote bag.
I mean, you have to keep it up for like 4 weeks, but yeah, I'll give you a tote bag. Yeah. I'm down with it. The WMS tote bag is going down. Well, you can get them. I think I can get them off of Spreadshirt or Coffee Press or something.
Just a Giant Eagle tote bag that we grabbed at Giant Eagle.
Oh, okay. You want me? No. No, those people, our Patreons are special to us. Okay, I'm going to go get them a Whole Foods tote bag. Ooh.
We're gonna brave that parking lot.
I don't think we're gonna break even with that. I think the Whole Foods tote bags are like way too expensive.
That's true too. Plus, there's the part of your soul that you leave behind. But anyways, let's talk about pro wrestling. So a lot of stuff happened over the last week. Course, the WWE is in turmoil. What's going
on?
All because of Kane, who wasn't even supposed to be here today because he was supposed to be in a Wyatt shed with Chevy Wyatt. And but you can listen to the Raw rap to figure out what Chevy Wyatt was about last night.
I love how this week on WWE said that nobody has seen Kane since the Wyatt family abducted him, yet they showed Seth Rollins wrestling Kane to get the injury.
It was a ghost.
Well,
it was
somebody said they were bright, Bobby.
Yeah.
So the big discussion going around, so we have this tournament going into the Survivor Series, and there was somewhere where it was supposed to be Kane versus Seth Rollins at a house show somewhere, and it ended up being the main event was Kane versus the Big Show. Mm-hmm. Insert groans here. how thin is this roster at this point? That they're at this point, and I mean, you know, you're looking at the tournament brackets, and there are no Randy Ortons, there are no safe bets to put the title on somebody. Actually, there's probably a safe bet that somebody new will get the title on this point.
One person.
What's that?
One person.
What?
Probably.
What?
One yes, person. The one man.
The one person that's in your basement, Sorg.
Black's going to get that title. Yeah,
all right. I knew you were always a supporter, Wheels.
You, Wheels. We love you.
But anyways, I mean, are we at a point where the roster is just not deep enough, you know, because we've had like 2 weeks of Raw previous to this, because I thought this week was a little bit of a bore personally. But we've had a lot of guys really stepping up, and you know, again, no signs of Cena's, no signs of anybody else. A lot of the newer, younger guys have been really kind of structuring Raw these days,
which is great.
Which is great.
Yeah, I mean, Tyler Breeze last night. I mean, so that was pretty cool to see him in his first match. I mean, it's a shame it was in a tournament, but at least we got to see him wrestle.
His first match was in a world title tournament match.
Yeah, so, yeah, I thought that was pretty impressive.
I guess you guys never seen him in a live event.
That says something about Tyler Breeze, because it's like, I mean, look at the New Day. They had a point. They were not in that tournament.
Right.
They put Tyler Breeze in that tournament.
Right. Fleck, you're saying they've not seen him live. We're talking about, like, this is his first Raw appearance.
Yeah, but it's not his first appearance WWE.
No. Obviously,
I'm
no.
not talking about NXT, but he has been on WWE live events.
Of course. But, I mean, those don't exist. Just like the Rockers Championship, but you know what I mean. But no, but it's bigger when you're on TV, on live television, and that counts a bit more. And that was effectively his debut on Raw. And I think is it his in ring debut, because he's only just kind of shown up on SmackDown the last couple of weeks, right?
Yeah, that was his first match on main roster. Other than that one back in the day where they did the tag match on Raw, showcasing the NXT talent, but that doesn't count.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was his first singles.
Wrestled too that day.
Yeah, I think they had Charlotte then.
The fact that that was her debut.
Yeah, yeah, right. Mm-hmm. We just forget about that. We had NXT stuff in the background, so nobody notices that, right? So, but I mean, I don't know why. Feeny Fleck, what do you think about kind of the state of the roster these days? Are you excited about the young talent at this point, or do you think they need somebody like a Cena to come back and kind of hold the flag for a bit?
I vote Elias Samson.
Oh, I fully support. Hey, you hear, if you haven't heard it yet, Elias Samson will be world heavyweight champion at some point in the next 5 years. Guaranteed.
There you go.
And if he doesn't, Pittsburgh riots.
I agree.
Of course, the former Logan Shulo that we have definitely had on this show a time or two. Shulo. So
he won a battle royal as Mustard.
Yes, he did. Mustard was freaking over. Did
amazing.
Did he win the battle royal? I thought he was just generally over or something. Oh, but
maybe, yeah, I thought everybody was listening on the shores because he won. Maybe
oh, no. Not there. I thought he was just everybody was a fan of him. Mustard was over that night. Good for him. You know what I mean? Hey, if Mustard gets a world title someday, that's fine too. But
hey, if Mustard gets the title, I guess he catches up.
Oh,
guys, this has been your wrestling mayhem show. Week.
I'm sorry, LB. I'm so sorry.
Lies.
You know, sorry. Answer your question. I think that there's too many young talents right now, and the fans need time to invest in that character till they fully support that character. Mm-hmm. You know, we're in a transition period again because you have the guys we grew up, you know, Taker and Trips are kind of phasing out. And then, like, the next round was Orton, Batista, Cena. Orton's almost out the door. You have Cena left. And after him, it's the next round of the new guys. And it's, you know, it's still taking time to build them as a brand.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, we have our Sheamuses. We have our Barretts. We have our, you know, those guys have been
around.
But
even them, they've been around, but they never really built up. In, like, Sheamus's hype, he was the world champ. And then it's like, just like everybody forgets Jack Swagger even held the title.
Right.
And
right,
then right, it's right. Like, he's there, but he's not.
Mm-hmm. Now, we do have, I mean, some guys that have been fairly significant. We got DelRio back, at least. So that's kind of an old standby for them. That if they need to, they can probably put it on the
and you
gotta
love Zeb Coulter. I mean,
as confused I am by what's going on right now,
I love Zeb. I just don't know what's going on.
Like, generally, yeah, no, Zeb's amazing. Well, what's happening?
I'm not happy with Zeb.
You're not happy with
Zeb? Happy with that man has stolen all the scooters that I like. I mean, what was up with the four ways on last night? Really? Did he really hit the switch and forget that they were there?
Wheels.
I'm sitting there going, would you turn off the flashers? Yes?
Wheels, I guess he didn't know that you already had that gimmick, right?
Right, I agree. Yeah,
that was your gimmick.
It's just going to be a handicap match down the road.
Oh.
Wheels versus Zeb.
Is that his gimmick, or does he actually have an issue? Like, does he have to be in a chair now? Like, or is that just straight gimmick?
This is actually, I was having... I had a conversation with wife of the show because I'm like, I'm so mad because nobody explains why the hell he's in the chair. He just showed up in the chair and he's been gone for so long. And even I think she said she remembered something happening to him like towards the end there that he was starting to come out in the wheelchair because he got attacked or something.
He got attacked and he had hip surgery, didn't he?
Did he like legit have hip surgery?
I think
or
so.
Something? So maybe
I think so.
So maybe
he but
can't?
That was so long ago. You wouldn't think he'd still need that thing.
You think maybe because he had hip surgery, is there some weird liability thing, and they have to make him come out in the cart now, or they're just like,
I mean, they're not that expensive, I guess. Some are, some aren't. I mean, you get the flashy ones like I have and what Zeb had last night. I mean, hey, if you can get some product placement in there, I mean, hey. Go for it.
More important than the actual scooters, I guess people want to know, like, do you really think that Del Rio needs Zeb by his side? I mean, does he need that mouthpiece? Or, you know, can Del Rio stand on his own? What do you think?
Honestly, I think Del Rio could stand on his own. Mm-hmm. I mean, he did before. I mean, he really doesn't need Zeb. And I don't understand why they put him with Zeb. So
yeah, the whole
thing
doesn't
make a lot of sense,
and the whole thing comes off so awkward. Just generally,
they're trying to capitalize on the whole thing with Trump.
Is that what's happening?
The problem is, yes. Isn't Vince and Trump still tight? So what's up with this angle?
I don't know, because it feels like they're trying to do something by, yeah, let's be unified by the guy that you say, let's build a wall. But so are they making fun of the people that want to unify? Is there a movement I don't know about that wants to unify?
Are they heel? Are they face?
Are we trying to annex Mexico for some reason?
I think
the annexation of Puerto Rico. Little Giants.
One thing maybe they're thinking about doing is I know they want a big Latino star for WWE.
Right.
Maybe this is a way to get Alberto over if he turns on Zeb eventually. You know, it's a way to maybe get him over with the Latino fans.
Del Rio coming back and taking the title was enough reason for him to get booed, but.
Or cheered. He was. Remember, they did it in L.A. and he came out to a major pop out there because it was true. L.A. Latino.
And it was John Cena he beat.
He beat All American John Cena in probably one of the more Latino crowds they could probably have in Los Angeles. I think that was perfect. And then they were like, well, it's up colder too. It was like, okay, now it's like, now what? And it's just awkwardness all around. And I'm just. I just feel like the slow burn on this is never going to pay off. And if that's the best thing we got in WWE right now, damn. No.
New Day.
Yeah, New Day. We could just build the entire company around the tag team division at this point.
That weren't allowed to bring their costumes in at the live event? They wore the unicorn costumes.
Really? This is another. Is this another kind of ringside? You're too distracting kind of thing, or
I think they got them at the door or something. Oh, I don't know the exact story.
That's sad.
There's four of them.
Those are your super fans, and that's how you're going to treat them. That's ridiculous. I think cosplaying should be completely allowed, regardless. I mean, you want to see that at ringside. I feel right.
Yeah, as long as it's not needs to be censored. I mean, who cares?
Right. Exactly.
Frank the Clown gets to dress as a clown every week.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're not going to let the unicorn thing happen. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, it can't be.
Sign guy has a stupid red hat and a stupid blue shirt.
He's everywhere. Did you get mad
He's
when you.
Cosplayed. The moral.
Did you get mad when you saw him at the WrestleMania ticket buying event?
Yes. Sign guy. And he was on Deal or No Deal a few years ago.
Hey, so leave Sign guy alone.
Yeah, okay. Him and Fleck are like.
No. We're not tight, but we did see him in Pittsburgh after seeing him on TV for how many times?
Wow.
Hey, the dude lost his wife. Leave him alone, seriously.
Oh, really?
Remember? Yeah, originally. Didn't you listen to the interview?
Wow. He's a widower. Wow. Bring all the fun down. Now I'm
sorry,
Sai.
Don't you guys? You guys were on a wrestling show and you didn't know that?
I didn't mean it.
It was back when they interviewed him. He's a widower. That's like...
I feel bad.
Everyone, go follow Sign Guy on Twitter. Get him verified if he's not already.
I'm going to start wearing a blue shirt and a red hat everywhere I go.
Well, there's that the guy that was on in the front row. There's a guy that wears a Hawaiian shirt and a red bandana. He goes to all the manias and stuff, and he was just there on Raw. I seen him. He travels a lot. He's from the UK. I seen him the first time was at WrestleMania 22 in Chicago. So there's a lot of people that try to single themselves out.
Yeah.
That you don't realize.
Everybody wants to be the hack guy from ECW.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, and what
straw hat guy.
What's that? Yeah.
Straw hat guy.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. I get that. You know, I definitely get that. I think you see that at indie shows a lot too. There's those wheels. You know, there's those people there in the certain seats that are always doing something, right?
I remember this one guy.
Heroin.
Remember this one guy? He used to always go to IWC shows and he used to wear a cut-off ECW shirt. Now his son's traveling the world wrestling, so that's cool. We're talking about Darren Daenerys' dad.
Oh!
For those that didn't know.
Oh, I didn't even
know. Yeah, and Darren would be with him, and Darren will laugh at that, but they used to be at all the IWC shows and everything. And I remember one day I was doing ring crew and he was like, you know, one day I'm going to be in that ring. And I'm like, okay, you know, work hard, buddy, you know. And he sure did it.
That was a free plug, by the way.
Free plug, Darren. Good job.
Yeah, he's all over the place. Good for him. All those guys are showing up.
He even wished me a happy birthday with all his travels. So that was really nice of you, Darren. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I wasn't going to get into this, but yeah, Garza's pointing out in the chat room, the clown guy, Frank the Clown, became Mr. Foley's son-in-law. Wait, did they get married?
Really?
I knew like he was like going out with Noelle Foley, but is that really what happened? Ugh.
What? Foley's daughter got married?
I love that.
So is Noelle training or...
I don't know. I kind of expect it any day now. She's on like Countdown all the time.
Right.
And she pops up on WWE Network like all the time in interviews. So she's getting in the vibe with even she's an announcer or something. I don't know. She's got to be somewhere around there.
Charlotte Flair versus Noelle Foley. WrestleMania 42. Oh, wait. Like they're not naming them anymore. They're not numbering them anymore. Sorry.
That's right.
What?
Speaking of, since you know Christmas is coming up, did you see that Santa Claus movie on Netflix? What was that called, like, with Mick Foley?
We don't.
Oh, the documentary.
Yeah, we just don't want to discuss that. We only continued to watch it for Foley.
It was a good documentary, though.
On like two of the Santas.
It was interesting.
It gets weird.
It definitely does.
Yeah.
But you're like, oh, I didn't know there was this weird Santa subculture that existed. This deviant Santa
raves.
Confession. No, they're not raves. They're not exactly raves. They got something else going on there.
Santa Netflix. They kind of like the furries.
Or not.
A lot like the furries, actually, now that I think about it. So, you know, there's like a Santa Claus bear club, and we'll just leave it at that. Okay, let's move on to something else here. We'll talk a little bit, kind of more Santa roster. I want to talk a little bit of Tyler Breeze in a moment, but in the meantime, speaking of some local wrestling, check out our friends indiewrestling.us. There's a lot of stuff going on over there.
That's
San Francisco.
That's
the right computer. Okay, sorry about that. IndieWrestling.us. Check out all kinds of fun stuff. We're carrying a lot of stuff, including Renegade Wrestling Alliance, Border City Wrestling from out of Canada, Scott DeMore's promotion, as well as International Wrestling Cartel, Vicious Outcast Wrestling, Best of Dalton Castle and IWC we have up there right now. The Weekend's RWA Open Season is just out there with Amazing Red versus Flip Kendrick. And, of course, the great Around the Indies. If you want to see what you're missing out on the weekend, Matt Carlins, our friend in the mainstream media, is doing a real great job there on keeping up on what's going on. And he sends me a message last night and says, I think every promotion in America had a show last night, and a lot of them are showcased here. And it's also a very visual kind of thing. If there's somebody out there great on social media with videos and stuff, he's putting it together for you. So you can get a nice, there's a chick just getting blasted in the face. There you go. I don't even know where that was or who that was, but you can go explore it over on indiewrestling.us/blog.
For the audio listeners, something it was funny. A man kicking a lady in the face.
I think I adequately described that situation there. And there's a guy going through barbed wire. All the best of the best. Go check it out. There's actually Matt Tremont of our friend from Indie Mayhem Show as well. Go check that out and check out some indie wrestling.
Man, Wheels is just really having fun with this girl getting super kicked in the face. Is that funny to you, Wheels?
He's dying over there.
Man.
You know, Wheels, you can wheel Don 51 and come visit us at a show.
I'm not going to say anything right now.
Yeah, we're going to leave that one. We're going to leave that bit right there. But go check out indiewrestling.us.
Thanks, Lord, for killing us all.
Right. It just surprised me because I didn't look at the article yet. I didn't know what was going to happen, and she got blasted in the face.
You totally knew. You commentated the whole thing. You were like, oh, push play. Girl gets kicked in the face.
Wow.
Whoa.
It's because you said she got blasted in the face.
And we had to describe it for the audio listeners that
it I'm caught up now.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's why we're laughing so
That's
hard.
That's why it's hilarious.
No idea.
Anyways.
No idea. All right. I said we had a pretty good debut. I know I've been keeping up on the Breaking Ground series, and I thought it was pretty appropriate actually that we had Tyler Breeze, as we mentioned, debut officially in match on Raw, officially, like we're going to remember it this time and not forget about it like we talked about before. Then also getting featured about how that character kind of came from nowhere and how it really kind of saved him kind of coming up through there. And I don't know. I wanted to get you guys' thoughts. You know, again, another NXT guy coming up through and really kind of retaining. One, the fans are down with it, and kind of seeing a great gimmick that's been developed and some really interesting stuff, like they've been doing with the iPhone kind of streaming to the screen, which looked like it didn't work on Raw actually last night. And kind of coming up through there. What do you know? Again, somebody that's not kind of arrived in the method that a Kevin Owens has against somebody like a John Cena, but I think another interesting character that's going to bring a lot if used right and doesn't become a party pooper like Adam Rose in so many months. What do you guys think about like kind of his chance and his positioning right now on the main roster?
I personally think he's a heck of a worker. I mean, just watch his matches. He's not all about the gimmick. I mean, when he's in the ring, he's business and he busts his butt, you can tell. So, you know, I hope the best for him.
It's also a great gimmick, though, too.
It is. It's very catchy.
And it works. It works. So, you know, we've had discussions on the show. I'm worried about, like, if you go from that crowd in Orlando and the people that are diehard in NXT and go to the common people in WWE. Like, I was excited on SmackDown when there were chants of "You look gorgeous," like there were at Full Sail in the common people crowd at a SmackDown. I think that's a big testament to his character? Is that a big testament to how much NXT has grown? That's like synonymous now when they come up, because we're not seeing people really turn into something else. The biggest change I think we've had is Neville just getting a cape, basically, right? But everybody else has been developed and then just brought up instead of brought up and then redeveloped and reintroduced, right?
I hate to keep blaming Vince McMahon, but you've seen it with the Ascension. They come up, they're red hot when they come up, and then they just don't do anything with them.
Right.
Bo Dallas. Red hot down in NXT, comes up, gets lost in the shuffle.
Right.
Adam Rose.
I'll give you Bo Dallas, but they did some really stupid stuff with the Ascension.
Yeah, well, yeah. Well, that's what I mean, though. It wasn't
the worst thing.
It wasn't like when they came up from NXT, they were really good in NXT. But when they come up to the main roster, they tried to make them Legion of Doom 2, which they're not. You know, and
that was their biggest
with Adam Rose, same thing. Like they didn't know what to do with him, and I just hope Tyler Breeze doesn't get lost in that shuffle. I don't think he's going to, but I hope. I don't know.
I want to speak to your Legion of Doom comment there with the Ascension. I think Ascension needed to be Legion of Doom to a certain point. I think I go back to Rusev. I think Rusev's build. No, maybe we don't like how it ended with John Cena, but his build as a super, super monster was so well done, right?
Yeah.
Ascension.
Lead a tank at WrestleMania.
Right. And leading to coming out on a tank at WrestleMania, I think it was the greatest moment. And then you can stop right there, right? But still, like just that accomplishment, right? Ascension should have just been ripping through people for months. And if anybody's going to get the title, it's them just ripping through people. They're completely unbeatable. And then somebody else comes out of, builds up maybe another team from NXT or something and does that. I mean, I'm more excited about the fact that somebody called them out to come down to NXT than what they're doing at this stage. Right. I mean, they're, but again, redirection, they're with Stardust. Do something with this, because I haven't seen anything on any of the main programs.
They're sitting at ringside.
They're sitting at ringside, but still, and they're popping up on Superstars, the main event, but as we discussed, who freaking watches that stuff anyways to know that there's some development happening there. But there's a lot of potential there with the Stardust Ascension thing, and I don't know, we'll see. I don't know, they've kind of stopped it for the moment, and it'll come back up, I hope. But I don't know.
I don't know. Two things I think they did good with Tyler Breeze so far is, I mean, he's with Summer, you know, so they put
great
him
pairing.
Right into that. Yeah.
Great
except
pairing.
For she's been with five guys in the last, like, 5 months.
We're not talking, about Summer.
But that's
we're talking
fine.
About
but
Tyler.
That's
but it's like
Summer.
It shows that they don't know what
okay.
to do with
no,
characters.
It shows that Summer is a whore.
This isn't the attitude era that we
the
solely
second
grew
thing
up on.
That they did good with Tyler Breeze is like there's so much comparison between him and Dolph Ziggler, right?
Right.
And they were like, bam, them two on the screen at the same time. And people were like, oh, well, I guess we don't have to talk about this much longer because they're there. Now, all of a sudden, we're seeing differences between
right,
them.
Right. Plus, Ziggler's going through that 90s denim phase thing that's going on, too.
Yeah,
so,
I don't know what
so,
that is.
I don't know. I think he bought a Harley and it was all over. But
it's all about I think the Tyler Breeze is unfortunately exactly the kind of guy that. That they will look at him and be like, okay, so we don't have to do anything. He already has a strong fan base. He's a great worker in the ring. And they're going to be like, all right, well, we just let him go. He's already popular. We don't have to work on him. You know,
that's going to be up.
He's going to get lost in the shuffle. They're going to yes. pull a Johnny Mundo on him.
Johnny Mundo.
I know. Wow. I can't remember. What was his name in
John Morrison.
John Morrison.
John Morrison. Yeah. Yeah,
I had the same problem like last week talking about some of this stuff. So yeah. I forgot what his name. I call him Jim Morrison at some point. I'm like, that's not right.
Jim Morrison.
That's two. No, that's
he's
the other guy.
Doors.
Yeah, yeah. That's actually the guy that he wants to be. But anyways, but no, that is a problem. You know, again, it kind of goes down to that writing structure and how those shows are put together. But I think. Yeah, he has a lot of potential. Jeez, just to have good matches. I think he's one of those guys that's going to be put in spots like we've seen where just we get Cesaro versus X person and was like, wow, we had a really good 20-minute match there right in the middle of Raw at the 9 o'clock hour. You know what I mean? Like, I think he's going to get those. I don't expect them to go for big titles or anything. Hopefully, get something good with an Intercontinental or a U.S. title. I guess more Intercontinental since we've become very. I don't know. I don't know how to put how the U.S. title has been. We're very patriotic with the U.S. title in the last year, haven't we? Okay, I guess that gives us a reason. It gives a little bit of weight to the title versus the Intercontinental. It's just like it is becoming, again, kind of the workhorse kind of belt with Kevin Owens and some of these other guys. So I'd love to see Tyler in a fight for that. You know, I think that's a perfect spot for him. You know,
I think he'll be in the Money in the Bank ladder match. Within the first couple of years.
Oh yeah, yeah. I think he'd be
he's
one of
like
those.
Made for it.
He's gonna be what? He's gonna be like the next Kofi Kingston. One of those things that just ends up at every one because it's like, hey, he's a good guy to do this. You know.
Mm-hmm.
Has he done a ladder match? Was he in a ladder match in NXT? I don't think so. None of his title matches.
Mm-hmm.
Were
I don't
that.
Know. I don't think.
So
I think another thing that kind of helps Tyler is something I noticed one week I was watching Raw. Was something you mentioned on Austin Cast tonight, Sorg, was that Facebook Live feature.
Okay.
He actually had Summer turn on his Facebook Live and had him coming out live on his entrance. So you're sitting there looking at Facebook Live and looking at Raw, and you're seeing it's real. It's happening right then. And that was pretty smart to do that using his Facebook Live and his Periscope type things.
And that is something that, yeah, they've already been doing a Periscope. But so we were talking about Facebook Live, and I actually got it pulled up here. So let me see if I can get it here. There we go. Yeah, this is them during their entrance on Raw, right?
Yes.
That we're looking at here. That's awesome. It's fun stuff that they're using technology. And even he talked about on Breaking Ground, it's like we were streaming on my phone to the screen on the Titantron. Nobody's done that before. It was something different. It was something cool. It adds to his character, that whole selfie mentality, right, and everything. I didn't even notice she was walking out there with a phone. I knew she was awkwardly posing along with him, which is great.
She always awkwardly poses. She looks lost sometimes.
But yeah, and it's just like she forgot actually to look through the camera and aim it at a certain point there, it seems. But again, you know, they're using some new tech. I mean, this is WWE just being smart, and he's the perfect kind of character to go along with it. Oh, she's actually, wait, what is happening here? So she's actually during the match still on Facebook Live, it looks like. This is,
yes,
this is pretty cool. And just her sitting at ringside. And what is, oh, this is during, is this during somebody else's match?
Yeah.
Did they
it was during Dolph's match, and he was sitting in his sitting in his VIP section.
Mm-hmm.
So smart. I mean, look, this is actually last week. Stick in there.
Okay. Oh yeah, that's awesome. That's amazing stuff. So good. You know, I think he's going to stand out because of things like this, to be quite honest. And hopefully that gets him kind of a better spot on the show. He doesn't get lost in the shuffle, you know, versus everybody keeps saying about Cesaro, you know, but Cesaro, I think he's a great personality, but he's not that, you know what I mean? But he's great in the ring.
Yeah.
And they're kind of right. But I think, man, everybody's getting behind him and you're kind of hoping they do something with him. So. They're sitting on. It's weird. They talk about how thin, I think confidently thin, the roster is right now. But there's just a lot of people that just need to step up. I mean, a lot of people missing. Who's going to be the next Rock and Triple H that steps up in the absence of our Seth Rollins, John Cena's, and Elias Randy Orton's? Elias Samson will do it.
Another plug.
There you go. Show title option. Summer is a whore. Let's not use that entirely.
Blast it in the face.
Blast it in the face. Anyways, you know what I like to have blasted in my face? Pepperoni pizza from our friends at SliceOnBroadway.com. Right here in the South Hills in Beachview, right along the tracks, as well as the main street in Carnegie, PA. They're supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza for over a year and a half here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show for our guests coming into the studio on this and everything else on podcast night every Tuesday night here. And thanks a lot to them. Check them out. Tell them that you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show, PGH_Slice on the Twitters, as well as the Slice on Broadway Facebook and Instagram, and you'll get hungry too. Thank you so much to Rico and the gang down there for supporting the show for so long. So let's take a look at what happened last week in Sorgatron Media, including some Sawtooth Willie, some and a bit about a bit more, including a little bit of our interview with Chris DeJoseph of Lucha Underground. We try to get some secrets out of him. And you can check out a little bit here and check out more from the Indie Mayhem show last week. We'll be right back.
Do you remember when we were kids and we would ride our bikes on the sidewalk?
I didn't have sidewalks when I grew up.
Remember? I didn't have anything.
I didn't have PBS.
This is just between me and Chilladow. No Mr. Rogers. No Canadian Mr. Rogers.
Did you have Legos?
Hey, man. My Duplo game was on point.
Oh, it's got a light bulb in it. Hot damn, that takes me back. Oh, that takes me back.
Hillary Rodham Clinton's presidential race, and you can just put different heads on that same form body. I would like to point out that the devil is one of them. So
I also didn't think they were going to use as many light tubes as they did. I just had, like, you know, lawyers like looking at me the entire time. I'm like, oh, it'll be fine, everything's cool, you know. A bunch of people came back to the control room, some investors in the show and executives, and they were like, that was amazing. Oh my gosh.
We're just gonna explain concepts in our childhood that we experienced and just explain it to him and our perceptions of that. Just like, let's just explain to the youngin, and you're like, what, like 12 years younger than me or something like that?
Sorg, that actually could be a really good podcast.
Oh yeah, the gang is here, Wrestling Mayhem Show. Check out everything that happened at SorgatronMedia.com. Still with us in the studio, Fleck and Feeny of CodeRedWrestling.webs.com. Find out if you're in the Pittsburgh area about their great event, supporting a great charity here in the area. Because everybody likes dogs.
What?
Everybody
what?
Likes dogs.
Oh, good. Sorry, I got said? One ear. This I can't.
She's blonde, Sork.
I'm blonde. Everyone loves puppies.
She bleaches it more people, but she is blonde.
There you go. There you go.
Everyone loves puppies.
There you go.
Show me the puppies.
So it's now time to get serious. I hope. I think. I don't know what direction this is going to go. Is this a question about puppies? It's time for the big question with Papa Lunchbox.
That's true. That's true, Sword. Well, I've been thinking about Monday Night Raw, Sword. Monday Night Raw. And I haven't watched Raw in a little while because I try, and then I turn it off. And then I come on here on the show, and everybody's like, well, that Raw wasn't so great. And I think, wow, I made the right decision. And we are not the only people who think and feel this way, because Raw's ratings are sinking deeper and deeper. It's not going well, especially in that third hour. People are not sticking around until the end of Raw.
Where all of us now, are falling asleep.
I think a lot of people are falling asleep.
I think no. We know, according to our Hangout, everybody is falling asleep in that last hour.
Yeah, exactly.
We're watching them drop like flies in that third hour.
Mike fell asleep last week.
Yeah. No. When I disappeared, that's because I'm probably going to go take a nap during the break.
Exactly.
You know what I do? It hits a break, and I tell my alarm to wake me up in two minutes via Siri, and try to wake up for the next match, and just power nap through the night. You know, just because that's what I'm doing. I've been doing that for like 2 or 3 months now. So,
is that the only way you sleep now?
It's the only time in the week I get a chance.
Just sleeps in 2 minute spurts.
Yeah. You know what? It worked for Einstein.
Trying to Batman it.
Kramer slept too. Seinfeld.
Kramer even sleep.
I think it was something like that. But that's not the point.
This week's
big question.
This week's big question is, what is the best way to sleep? Is it in 2 minute spurts?
Is it in watching the third hour Raw or 24 hours of Bob Ross on Twitch? I don't know. I don't know.
Oh, man. I watched a couple episodes of Bob Ross last night, and it was the best decision I've ever made.
I loved when he finished the painting, everybody just would type GG.
Can we have a similar Twitch channel as just Finn Balor putting together Lego sets? Because I think
I would subscribe to that $4.99.
With his Irish accent, which I will never get. Now we take the almighty corner piece and apply it to the L-shaped piece, and then
Becky Lynch can come in and like break it.
Yeah, there you go.
I love Finn Balor.
Becky Lynch.
Awesome. Everybody had a moment as half of it was like, ah, Becky Lynch. And then all the girls out there, which I know, are going, ah, Finn Balor. I don't remember the last time there's a wrestler that came on the screen, and every time my wife is with me, it's like, you know, I'd leave, like basically along the lines of, you know, I'd leave you for him. You know, that's.
He's delicious, Sword.
Interesting, though. Did you notice they were kind of changing his gimmick up a little bit?
The jacket bit?
Yeah.
I
think they need a side gimmick for him because he has the demon. And then, like, when he's regular Finn, he's just like, it's Finn Balor. You know, but now he's like cool Finn Balor with the fawns.
You know what? I don't mind that. Hey, apparently Finn Balor also got a Harley with Dolph Ziggler, and he's going with that, too. But no, from what I understand, that's kind of a Japanese kind of look, too. So. Everybody's got a motorcycle. And they're riding with Baron Corbin. But not Baron Corbin, because he rides alone.
Yeah, because he's alone.
He's a lone wolf. Doesn't like anybody. He wants to punch a guy, but he didn't. Good for him. He didn't punch a guy.
And he's going to go listen to 90s rock music.
Can someone tell me why Tyler Breeze and J.J. Dillon were like hunting for bats or something like that on the show.
Didn't they say that's what Canadians do or something?
Okay, guys, she said J.J. Dillon.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I thought I heard that too.
Yeah. I have to bury her. Because I'm like, I'm seeing J.J. Dillon. I'm like, when did J.J. Dillon hang out with Tyler Breeze?
J.J. Dillon is the hottest new prospect on NXT right now, J.J. Dillon.
I'm sorry. I'll email him and apologize.
And by the way, not implying anything, but that little segment was a little bit gayish.
Say that word. You cannot say that word.
Oh, no.
You're happy?
Yes.
Very happy.
It was very happy. Just so you know, Tyler Breeze has a girlfriend. Instagram it.
Summer Rae.
No, it's not Summer Rae. It's not Summer Rae.
I can't believe we haven't gotten to the big question yet.
What was the big question? Dude, how do you not watch Raw? What's
LB,
wrong with you?
LB, what is the big question?
Uh, basically, to sum up, Raw sucks. How do we fix it?
Ride the roller coaster.
What?
Fuck the roller coaster. I've been riding it forever. How do we fix it?
I'm still riding it.
Build new shoes.
Let's see. How do we fix it?
Kill an hour. Kill an hour, basically.
Yeah, take away an hour. Yeah. Take away an hour and just more Tyler Breeze.
If they're getting bad ratings, good. Image. The experiment is finally failing. You're about to turn into 2001 Nitro, and USA is going to cut your hour. There's going to be a
reckoning.
WWE.com bubble burst. Basically, they're going to lose half of their TV on regular television. It's not going to affect the network necessarily because they still get more people watching on network than anywhere else. I think you're going to get to a point where they lose half of their TV in America and we get a partial TNA situation where they're just going to make all their bank with all their shows on foreign markets and throw half of that stuff on the network. I think they lose something like SmackDown per se. Maybe they cut that out too. We're down to 2 hours of Raw. That's it, because they've oversaturated the market with their own stuff. And they move the shows that have been canned over the WWE network.
Yeah, but
you've
SmackDown's
really thought this through.
No, what?
SmackDown's moving to USA.
Yeah,
right.
Now it's gonna be 5 hours of TV.
Right, we'll see how that goes. USA. We'll see how that goes until the ratings bottom out enough and they start cutting an hour of Raw, which I think they will. I think it's going to get a point where it's going to get so bad, Raw's rating is dropping, but it's still like one of the best rated things consistently on cable. That's the thing.
I don't think it's dropping because it's 3 hours, though. I enjoy 3 hours. I love it. I have nothing else to do on my Monday night for 3 hours. I mean, seriously.
Thank you.
I don't watch football.
Thank you for admitting that you are.
That was the loser sign for that was some.
She watches
that was some,
it.
That was some Bella
right next
Bella
to me when
loser
she's
sign
not sleeping
for you on audio there. Wow. But
seriously, go back to this because they were supposed to quit the third hour like way back when. Because remember, like the camera guys were complaining and other stuff, but you never heard anything about it
because they started paying them more or something. Or they say that you're a union, screw you.
But the other thing was it's just they're showing 3 hours of video instead of they're going to still be at the live events for 4 hours, three and a half, 4 hours. So why not show that hour?
Jeez,
Right?
Yeah,
exactly.
Because if they cut it to a 2 hour show, they're going to still be giving us three to four hours of wrestling.
Right.
So, I mean, why not show it?
Right.
Well, it's all about money in the end, so.
And that's it. And that's it.
I just think that today's kids are so pathetic that they're so, they're home and they're not allowed to do anything, that they don't understand what professional wrestling is to sit there and turn it on and watch it.
What conversation did this just turn into?
I don't know.
A whole different other conversation, but today's kids are like,
He's healing out here. I don't.
Honestly, Fleck is right. Kids of today are stuck on their iPhones or tablets.
I thought we got all get out of my yard.
The
last
reason
week.
Why April, or Sarah and I
Who?
Run
Who?
Our own wrestling promotion. Sarah. We run our own wrestling promotion is to make sure that it keeps evolving. Like, make sure next generation of kids come and watch shows. Like, we love it when the little kids come up to us because they're into wrestling. If everybody was our age and coming, it would die. We don't want it to die. We want it to continue on.
You want your younger crowd to be attracted to wrestling because that's where, like you said, your money's coming from.
Exactly.
Because Mommy and Daddy aren't always going to be excited for maybe this guy or that guy. But Junior's sitting there going, hey, I want to go see Fleck wrestle this guy. I want to go see Feeny do this guy. I want to see...
Whoa.
What?
Super
Not
King?
That way.
Well, you got our minds, Anyway, do you think they'll bring Rey Mysterio back to WWE? I mean, we talk about little kids here and... Those that are popular.
No.
Kalisto's the new Rey Mysterio.
That's true. They learned they don't even need to get the guy that's usually under the mask in order to make a character and sell action figures. No, they're fine. They're absolutely fine.
Yeah.
Although, who else is ready for that barn bird of match of Kalisto versus Ryback?
Daniel Rubin. Good answer.
Is there
going to
be another injury during that match?
Is he, who?
I don't know.
Ryback?
That's just like awkward to have that match. It's like Big Show versus Rey Mysterio.
It could
like,
be amazing. It could be amazing.
It's hard to watch.
I mean, look at the insane stuff that Kalisto does.
And
he just like does. He's going to get killed in a fantastic way. Basically.
Ryback's just going to throw him in the air.
What if Kalisto like
do, like,
wins?
500 tumbles and fall.
Kalisto wins. It'll be amazing. It'll be amazing, and Dan Hooven will quit the internet.
He should have upsets in this tournament. I mean, to make it surprising.
Hey, Sheamus lost.
I would say Sheamus lost.
That was
a
50-50.
Did you really expect them to give it to Cesaro in that one? But so, I mean, at least we get... Good.
I just want to let things happen.
What?
I don't know.
I mean, the only reason why I thought Sheamus was going to win is because he had Barrett out there with him. It would only make sense, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Did everybody answer the big question here? Do we have any answers from the chat room? How do we fix Raw?
Question.
What's that?
Bring Vince back?
I said build new superstars. Now's the perfect time to do it. You got so many guys that are like the old guard on the shelf right now. You got Big Show out, possibly. Randy Orton's out due to a shoulder garbage can injury. Mm-hmm. Cena's on vacation. Nikki Bella's on vacation.
Is she injured?
I thought she'd just take a vacation with John, more or less.
That's what I thought, too.
I thought it just worked out that way.
Now's the opportunity to build these new guys. Like, do something with them.
Mm-hmm.
How to fix Raw, rehire Russo from Garza out there. Garza actually reached out apparently to Vince McMahon and says, please, please, you need help. So at least he says that's what happened. So I don't know. Garza's also pointing out that Jason Jordan plus Ty Dillinger is JJ Dillon.
Yeah,
that's where you got it. That's where you got it.
She got it because she's a blonde.
Oh.
Because she's a blonde. Yeah. I'm old enough to know that
song. Thanks for putting that in my head.
Well, that's happening right now.
It's Cyndi Lauper, right?
Yes.
And that what movie was that?
Wasn't it Tank? No, not Tank Girl, I think. Was it? Yeah, maybe it was Tank Girl. I don't know.
Anyways, yeah. Wow. This is where we just like lose and just drop a bunch of references in the second half.
Into anywhere, they just start taking over. So.
There you go. Before we start talking about the Burger King Kids Club again, but other than the cut the third hour, I think they've been doing good lately about having threads through the show, like especially with the Seth Rollins stuff. Now they don't know what to do, so all that's out the window. I think all the ideas are gone. I think they had been working with him long enough. They had some good stuff, but even I was watching what was it? It was the countdown show. And they were talking about it was the Strange Bedfellows, and they were talking about some of the vignettes they would do. And I remember there was like Renee Young sitting there, like, why don't we do that stuff anymore, right? And which again, like they used to go, like they followed Bischoff to Texas to a bar and had him get in a bar fight and all this stuff, or the trial of Eric Bischoff, right?
NXT's been doing vignettes for a while.
And they have been doing it, and they've been fantastic. Mm-hmm. But it seems, I feel like they're stretched so thin because of that third hour. They don't have anybody to say, hey, go to the bar here in town, and we'll set this up, and we'll shoot this scene with so-and-so person. Like it was so great in that 10 Attitude Era through, because they got out of their element. APA was in bar fights, you know.
Is that was the Attitude Era, so a lot of that stuff
but
was.
But even along after that, though, right? Like, well into the SmackDown Raw brand split, I think they did that a lot.
Was Dean Ambrose the last one they actually did that with? Like with him with the hot dog cart and him walking to Stanford, Connecticut, to the headquarters.
More or less, mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
And then what was the other one when he stole the vehicle?
Yeah, they're really kind of reenacting Stone Cold with him in this, and not terribly original there, but still, it's something out there, you know. Mm-hmm. Or even like backstage segments seem so standard anymore. And then I'm watching the one part about Goldust and Booker T, and you see, or even Blackman and Al Snow, head cheese. Mm-hmm. And they're shooting the stuff like just in the locker room, and it looks so confined and not, you know, it's just a general arena locker room, wherever the heck they are.
Off stage interview. So they're still out there for the fans, but they're off in a corner. Remember when they used to do that back
the platform with Mean Gene Okerlund?
Yeah,
I do
like
enjoy
it gives
that.
It a different point of view.
Right, right. I don't think that's required, but I would appreciate that.
Because then, like, the next match is coming out, and they're still, like, they're showing that long shot. It's just...
Yeah. WCW was really good.
Did they switch? Remember they used to show those other camera angles? They don't do that anymore now either.
Which
remember they're showing like the camera above the ring and stuff. They don't even do
not
that anymore.
Above the ring, and they don't even
it
they don't use the ones
post.
On the posts, but they use the ones with the posts in a WrestleMania promo, because they did one where like Wyatt was doing his backwards thing like into the post. And like that was a really interesting.
It's like they tried it for a little bit and then they stopped.
But they're still using it for promotional stuff. And I think that's really important, because when they're able to do that in post, they could clean it up a little bit. They don't have a good mechanism, because you notice like pay-per-views and stuff, they would start using it a little bit, and they'd show a shot from somebody going into the post or something, right? Mm-hmm. And remember how different that footage looked? And when, on that level of video production, you have to have everything even out. Yeah. It's jarring to the user. Be like, oh, what's that? You know, yeah, it's the GoPro or whatever they stuck in there, right? Mm-hmm. But it has to match everything else, and there's no way to do that currently in that little technology in that post, at least on that level, what they're doing on WWE. So, but it's been interesting.
My question is, with those like cameras in the post, I wonder how much heat they can handle from lately with Bray Wyatt doing the flames going up every 5 seconds. I mean, that's probably a lot of heat coming from those posts.
If they're GoPros, they're probably okay. Or they might have some shielding in there.
Is the heat inside the post much?
No, like, it's outside.
Really, it's kind of mostly out.
It's a blast. And I don't think it's enough to affect it, and it's so
quick. I have mortars at home, and even the cylinder doesn't get
right. And we would actually take cameras into steel mills, and we dealt with heat a lot, like to the point where like the feet of the tripods would be melting off, you know, like that kind of issue would happen from time to time. So I mean, those things can typically handle a bit, and they're probably using digital and everything. So they've done precautions, and they may have melted a few before they figured it out, to be honest. But
we have some breaking news.
Oh,
from going back to our earlier conversation, Big Show is actually not hurt. He was just selling the injury, and they actually did a comedy skit after the show.
Side note, Matt Carlin's. Matt Carlin shared a great interview with Dean Ambrose, where he used visualization about the small package and how you can get out of it 99. You can't get out of it 99% of the time if it's a perfectly executed small package. And something about running to the cows, and he walked up to the cows, and that's where Tyler Breeze made his mistake.
Also see the Kevin Owens one?
I did not see the Kevin Owens one.
The Kevin Owens one is just as good too.
Okay. I think they're like in a competition for most irreverent wrestling promo that they can do at this point. Okay. LB, did we answer any of your question?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So let us know what you think. Well, how do you fix Raw these days? All right. So from there, LB, you get the next segment too. This is wrestling related. This is a crossover with PanelRiot.com as well.
That's true. That's true.
It all
also
works out.
On the Sorgatron Media Network.
Yeah, that's right. Good friends.
So for those who don't know, there used to be a guy who was a professional wrestler. He quit, though, and his name was CM Punk.
Who?
He decided that he was going to do a bunch of other stuff. Because he liked being famous and wanted to continue to be famous, but not for the thing that made him famous. One of those things that he decided to do was become a comic book writer. And I got to tell you, he did all right at it. He has had some kind of some one-offs every now and then. He did a Thor annual, and he did a story in a Thor annual, and he did something for DC or something that I didn't read. But he has his first ongoing comic book, and it is Drax the Destroyer from Guardians of the Galaxy. And I read it, and I got to tell you, it's not bad. is written by CM Punk, but also Cullen Bunn, who's a known quantity over at Marvel. And it's probably kind of it's hard to tell, you know, who took what, because Punk's writing in the other books has been kind of rough. I wouldn't call it clever. I would call it pretty standard. Scott Hepburn does the art and does a great job. Everything's a little stylized and a little brutal, which is what you need for a book like this. Matt Millett did the coloring, and it's great. It starts with Drax joining the other Guardians, and it's the new lineup of Guardians. It's changed a bit from the movie. You've got Venom as one of the Guardians now. Ben Grimm from the Fantastic Four, and Star-Lord is now Kitty Pryde.
What?
Yeah. Not making that up. Star-Lord is now Kitty Pryde.
Okay.
All right.
And they're fighting these weird space zombies who are also a cult and also going to set off a bomb and everything like that.
I want to make clear, like, Venom isn't Eddie Brock. Like, it's this, like, military guy, right? Actually, it's Flash Thompson, isn't it?
It's Flash Thompson, yeah. It's Flash Thompson, and he lost his legs and then got the Venom symbiote, and now he's in space with the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Kind of Flash, you got no legs. Sorry, continue.
So they introduce all the Guardians, and one of the big aliens is sneaking up on Rocket, and you get a great full page where Drax rips the alien in half, and this is pretty indicative of what you see in the comic, because Drax is brutal and violent, and, you know, the way that he should be. The book is really well written, and the dialogue is very snappy. One of my favorite parts is all the Guardians, you know, they finish their mission and they're all like, all right, well, I'm going to go do this and I'm going to go do this. And Drax is like, oh, you guys are all going to do stuff? I guess I'll go kill Thanos. And they try to stop him, and they're like, wait a minute, you're going to stir up something crazy. And Drax is like, well, you guys are going to do your things, and, you know, that's what I do when I'm not with you. I go to kill Thanos. Rocket gives him a terrible ship, and the ship crash lands, and that launches us into our new our next big adventure. You don't really – if you didn't know, you wouldn't tell. There's no obvious signs that this is a book written by CM Punk, with the few exceptions of at one point his fists are wrapped up 100% like CM Punk wrapped his fist.
Do you have an X on his hands?
He doesn't, but I fully expected there to be one.
Could you imagine a straight edge Drax?
Yeah. Yeah. No drugs, no alcohol, just murder.
Murder is my anti-drug.
Murder was the case they gave me.
It's good. It's very, very good. I'll review it kind of the way I do it on Panel Riot. Is it a good introduction for the character? Yes, it absolutely is. Is it an interesting book? Yes, it is, and it absolutely makes me want to read the second issue, because I want to know where they go with this. I want to see if CM Punk is consistent in his writing, and I'm hooked. And the third question: should you read it? You absolutely should. It not necessarily because you're a fan of CM Punk, but because you're a fan of Drax or because you're a fan of comics. It's a good comic. Go and check it out. It is available now.
All right, and of course, you know, the Punk is writing Batista's character from the movie is kind of pointed out here. And Kitty Pryde and Star-Lord got married. I don't know if he's making a joke or if that's really what happened.
What's that?
Did Kitty Pryde and Star-Lord get married?
Yes.
Okay.
As far as I know, I think they did get married, and then he became he's ruling Spartax.
Oh, it took over for his dad.
Yeah. And then she took over for him. It's a whole thing and something I need to get caught up on. But
did Kitty Pryde and Colossus get a divorce?
Oh, they were never married.
They were never married, and then he died. And then he became – And then he got this is turning into another podcast again.
Yeah.
Because he was the juggernaut for a while.
That's right. So he was kind of a rage beast. Plus, then he was on the wrong side of the X-Men split. Then Kitty, and it just did not end up well. So. Yep.
I mean, and he's American. Now soon he'll be British. I mean.
What?
What?
Sorry. I was going to talk about Colossus. Sorry.
He's American?
In the other X-Men, he was.
Oh, in Ultimate X-Men.
Right.
Even the older, like the older.
Okay, let's get back to wrestling, guys. anyways.
Welcome to Panel Riot Mayhem Show.
Right,
show title option, Straight Edge Drax. All right, guys. Drax. I want to know, what did you learn from wrestling this week? Bobby?
I learned that my favorite tag team of all time made a comeback this week.
Oh?
That's right. That's right. Phone Booth and Carr, the British tandem that appears only in England.
Can we talk about that? Because I was thinking the same thing. Can't they like put it like a clock or something else?
It's just what we do. We're formulaic.
That's the only props WWE has when they're in England. They like get them out of cold storage.
Wait, cold storage? Like cryo storage? Is that what you're saying?
They freeze the car and the phone booth.
That's why it still looks as good as it did in the 30s? Is that what you're
saying? Yes. Yeah. It's the Queen's personal phone booth and the Queen's personal car.
Right. LB, what did you learn? Hopefully about actual wrestling.
I learned that one of the best things to ever happen to Wade Barrett's career is getting slapped by a footballer.
Yeah.
Because they are going nuts because Wayne Rooney smacked him in the face.
Mm-hmm.
And he went down.
Way to ignite a nation. Mm-hmm. Wow. That was great. A good bit of them like making the most out of being in England, you know.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for that Doctor Who crossover, but whatever. Wheels, how about you?
Well, I'm going to steal something from my Facebook post because I didn't know if I was going to be on tonight. So, I'm going to say that what I learned from wrestling was, Sorg, the bleep button is your best friend.
Yeah.
And man, you were hitting that baby good.
You like how that came out?
My God. It kind of reminded me of unnecessary censorship off of, I forget which talk show it was.
Jimmy Kimmel.
Shit. That's it. Thank you. And I'm like, this is beautiful. I love the bleeps.
So we're doing the RWA wrap up, and there's a thing where Jesse Bell Smothers got pile driven and carried off, and Shane Andrews comes out and talks about how he wants a match. And there was a lot of F-bombs in that, and I figured it would probably be prudent to mute that a little bit. So I like using the beep whenever I can, like the sensor beep. It's just...
And it was beautiful.
Like, in editing, it's fun for me for some reason. I've had a need to use it only a couple of times in my life. So I had a lot of fun with that one. So
I enjoyed it myself, Sorg, so thank you, sir.
Go and check it out. Go to Renegade Wrestling Alliance for on the Facebook page or the YouTube or rwalive.com for that info. Fleck.
What's up?
What'd you learn from wrestling this week?
Jeez. I don't know.
Sera Feeny, what'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned that Wheels really thinks it's funny when a girl gets blasted in the face.
Blasted in the face! Oh, I know what I learned last week.
What did you learn last week?
That the Survivor Series match isn't important enough to have on Survivor Series, that they have to have it on Raw and then on SmackDown to totally kill Survivor Series.
Yeah.
And then when I found out about the tournament, I was all excited, and then they killed it because they didn't have it in one night, like, what was that, WrestleMania?
Yeah, but you see how many matches they have?
Yeah. Yes.
Like, that's a lot to do in one night.
But you know they're not even going to have the quarterfinal matches. They're still going to be, you know, at least have, like, 8 matches on the actual
I think we're going to have 3. Show. I think we're going to have 3. They were trying not to overextend.
I think they said they were going to only have 3 matches at the pay-per-view or something
like sense.
That.
It makes sense. Yeah. No, I think that's fine. It's a deadly game! I learned that the deadly game is real and it's still alive!
Is there still going to be a Survivor Series match, though?
No, absolutely not. I don't think so.
Is it going to be the Wyatts? Is it going to be 4-on-2?
Nope.
Wyatts versus Taker?
Nope.
How they plan
that? I don't know. I don't know what they're going to do. I think it's just going to be a buried alive match or something like we've been talking about.
That would be awesome, bringing that back.
I think that's fine. Let's do that. Greatest Hits tour of all of Undertaker's like classic matches.
And what if they totally throw a wrench in there and Undertaker like retires at Survivor Series and doesn't have another WrestleMania go?
I don't think that'd be a problem.
Yeah, be sad. No, I think they could do that, yeah.
I mean, all that high. I mean, 25 years. I mean, that's where he started. That's where he could finish it.
I think it's a good spot. Yep. I'd like to see them. If they're going to do it, I think it's a good spot for him. Certainly.
Undertaker's going to crawl back into the egg. the gobbledygooker. Just leave me here.
Jeez.
They need to bring that back, too, for that Survivor. Last time we seen a gobbledygooker, what was that?
That was the same year. It was 25 years ago.
No. They did it. They rehashed it.
Gimmick Battle Royal.
Gimmick, yeah.
Yeah, like 2021? Yeah. No, 19, yeah, maybe? Like WrestleMania 19?
Iron Sheik will win again just because he can't get eliminated because of his hips.
I don't think he can even get in the ring at this point. So, no. From the internets, what did everybody learn? First of all, from the Twitter, our friend Ed Burke, Patreon supporter, the WWE never changes. There was a lot of talk of change last night. That was interesting.
That was a Fallout 4 reference.
Oh, is it? Wait, was everybody referencing Fallout 4 last night on Raw? Is that what was happening?
No. Just war never changes. WWE never changes.
Oh. Matt Collins learned that when Tyler Breeze finally beat Dean Ambrose, his wife will quit WWE. also learned that the curb stomp is back thanks to Zara Schreiber. Cheap around the indies plug, so that's out
her
there
finisher
too. It's apparently her finisher. She debuted it at a show this weekend, so Alex Carr is out there in Long Beach, California, learned that National Pro Wrestling Day is coming back.
National Pro Wrestling Day.
He messaged me.
Go to that event?
I went to the original, yes, with Shulo and Chuck Roberts. That was interesting, and McChesney was there too. That was a crazy night in Philadelphia. But anyways, he actually messaged me and asked if he could use part of the show because for his Chikara podcast. And I'm like, dude, we're Creative Commons. You can do whatever you want with the show. So I want to put that out there, guys. We're Creative Commons. You can do whatever you want with this show.
You can blast her in her face in the comments.
Even that part, you can use that part. And do whatever you want.
Hey, Wills, you need to put that on your wheelchair.
There you go. That could be a soundboard that you play at the RWA. Blast in the face!
No, not doing that.
Wheels? I'm going to skip yours.
Yes.
All right. I don't have this picture ready to go, but Kiko on the message on the group, on the Wrestling Mayhem Show group, says, this right here, AJ Styles is taking that, and it's AJ Styles pointing at the title in New Japan Pro Wrestling. So there's that. Daniel learned that Barrett is the Drew McIntyre of 2015. I'm sorry, Matt Garland's. Garza learned that watching Hama versus Ishii gave me a headache and a potential concussion via television screen. I also learned that WWE, TNA, and AAA titles are all vacant. Jay Lethal is the greatest first generation champion in America. Mm-hmm. There you go. And we talked about that a little bit too. Side note, the GOP debate is hot. The moderators have lost control. What are we doing talking about wrestling?
People in there.
So breaking news, there's that. Guys, it's been a lot of fun. Hey, thanks a lot, Fleck and Feeny of Code Red Wrestling. CodeRedWrestling.com. CodeRedWrestling.webs.com and look up Code Red Wrestling on all your social medias.
November 21st.
There you go.
Fall Slam.
What do you guys got lined up?
A pie in the face match.
What?
We got.
Wait.
Yeah.
What's a pie in the face? Well, who's in the pie in the face match?
Well,
it was going to be Sera Feeny versus somebody, but somebody backed out.
Somebody.
So now Sera Feeny's going to tag with me in a traditional
In a traditional pie in the face match?
go to Facebook to hear more about that.
Jeru and Johnny Switchblade.
Yes.
Private face match.
That's right.
Well, there's some names I haven't heard.
And
in
because
a while.
I'm angry, because I was supposed to be in the pie in the face match, they better not hope that I don't bring two pies out to the ring and smash them in both of their faces.
I think Feeny might be sneaking pies in people's faces.
So I'm the pie mad. In the face match was supposed to be a ladies' match?
It was supposed to be a ladies' match. Yep, we got the women's championship match. We got Cheyenne versus the beautiful Bea. And then we were going to have
crown the
me.
World. Don't forget about the new CRW champion. Malachi versus Dan Sandwich, who I currently despise, versus Ryan Swift from Canada.
Which Ryan Swift is popular right now. Why, Fleck?
You know that guy that was on the top rope and puked? That's Pepper our boy, Parks Ryan
match.
Swift. Come see him at
what?
Code Red Wrestling.
Yes.
What is this?
Sorg, you don't know?
I don't know.
He's famous right now.
Ouch.
It wasn't on around the indies, so I have no idea.
The most important thing is he still finished the move. After he puked. In the front row.
I want to know, what kind of pie is it going to be, Sarah?
Pumpkin. It's going to be pumpkin pie.
Mm. Oh. Why would you waste a good pumpkin pie like that? Bring it to me.
Can I volunteer? I'm angry. Can I volunteer to lose this match?
Sorg,
are you coming to the show?
Oh, Sorg, we'll talk.
Are you filming a wedding that day or another promotion? I think there's only one other promotion in Pittsburgh going on that day, so I think you're free.
We'll talk.
We'll talk
after this.
We'll see.
Chachi can film the wedding, and Rob can film the wedding.
Yeah,
you can come.
Chachi doesn't like wrestling anyway.
Yeah.
Bring me pie. I want pie. Especially pumpkin pie.
Oh,
all right, check him out. And of course, you're on Twitter as well, at Sera Feeny.
Yes. And Fleck off.
Fleck off on
I don't
Twitters.
Use my Twitter, guys.
No, I didn't think that's like
you
I'm
might
like,
look up something and see like TARDIS sayings, but other than that, I don't got
puppies.
Time. I barely
puppy
have time
pictures.
For Facebook.
You had that pool puppy picture.
That was almost a whole year ago.
The best kind of party to be
puppy
at.
Bowl. Because, ladies puppy. And gentlemen, you know what FNF does during the Super Bowl? We watch the Puppy Bowl
puppy
and
bowl.
The commercials. We could care less about the Super Bowl.
We
that's
care
fact.
About. We love puppies.
That's a fact. I agree. I
there
love puppy
go.
Bowl.
Wheels, Hot Wheels, RWA on the Twitters. RWALive.com for stuff that he's involved in. And bleeps.
Follow me. Yes. I do selfies now. With
yes.
my selfie stick.
Selfies, he
come
does.
On, sing Tyler Breeze's entrance. Please, Wheels.
I don't know it all.
I don't know. You guys haven't seen, but Wheels is up on a pedestal now, basically.
Hey, it's Wheels.
At
wait,
the
what?
Shows. Like, we moved all the tables up on stage, so he's, like, overseeing the RWA shenanigans. So I just want Wheels.
Is this so you have more seats there?
Well, that, and so, like, wrestlers don't end up on my table anymore. I'm just envisioning this thing where the lights are going off, Tyler Breeze's music goes off, and
it's
you're
Tyler.
Just you're just up there, you know, going crazy with it. There you go.
Sword, I think you gave me an idea.
There you go. Rocking the Tyler Breeze. Bobby F. J. Town, he's at insertcoin2begin.com. Successfully surviving the extra life tournament boss battle. Also surviving that extra life is Papa Lunchbox at DJ Lunchbox on the Twitters. PanelRiot.com if you like how he talks about comics. Find out more. And other familiar voices talking about comic books as well.
Mm-hmm. It's true. Coming up on our 50th episode is a celebration. Everybody should go to panelriot.com and have a drink.
And Sawtooth Willie, there's a wrestling crossover.
We're straight edge.
Lunchbox, I'd like to say something. Thanks for dressing up. You've really made me feel awful.
That's the greatest compliment you can give someone in a bow tie.
I know, but he's got a bow tie.
This dude can't even watch Raw. Oh. He has too much time on his hands to go look in front of the mirror and put his bow tie on and think he's John McChesney. He doesn't
you're right.
Look
I can't
John
watch
McChesney.
Raw
because
it's Tyler unwatchable.
And I think, and of course, Sawtooth Willie, Scott Steiner makes an appearance on Sawtooth Willie this week. So go look that up as well.
I love Sawtooth Willie.
There you go. Sorgatron.com, Sorgatronmedia.com, WrestlingMayhemShow.com, including the great columns by our friend in the mainstream media, Matt Carlins. He actually broke down our interview with Chris DeJoseph of Lucha Underground, co-executive producer and the former, can we say, member of DX of a sort? You may know him as One Big Dick Johnson, writer for the WWE. We almost got through the interview without dropping a reference.
Yeah.
Almost. But he kind of set one up for a man like there. So go check out that great, almost an hour interview we had with him on the Indie Mayhem show last week. And so much more. Thank you, everybody. WrestlingMayhemShow.com, live at SorgatronMedia.com, 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Every Tuesday, you can join us in the chat room like our good friends, like Garza, like Matt Carlins, like everybody else that was in there. Wheels is usually in there. I don't know. I can't remember. All the names are fake now because they're doing a weird thing now. And also, please go to WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to everything. Follow us on Twitter at Mayhem Show, Wrestling Mayhem Show on the Facebook, on the Google Plus, the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group. And I think that's everything. Thank you, wife of the show. Nobody's going to do it?
Where's Missy?
My wife.
There you go. Thank you. Wife of the show on Twitter has been doing the tweets and the notes and everything all night long. Big thanks to her. Thank you, everybody. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.